sang at Kathy and I's wedding a few years back. And she, this is a former mayor, very warm-hearted, committed Christian, and she has this neighbor, Bruce, who doesn't know the Lord, and she's been very concerned about him because he's dying of cancer. And so she goes over and she talks to him and she asks for permission to pray with him. No, I'm not interested in that. Well, can I share Jesus with you? No, I'm not interested in that. She got a call yesterday from Bruce's wife. Betty, you've got to come over right now. Thinking the worst, she runs over to Bruce's house and he's actually alert. He recognized her, and so she's in the bedroom with him there, and she says, "So, Bruce, are you ready to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior? You know, the Bible says that you will repent of your sins, and you'll ask Jesus to forgive you, to come into your life, and you'll be one of his disciples." And he kind of mumbled something. She wasn't sure what he said, and she has a hearing loss, so she was even more handicapped at that point. And so she asked him again. Then the man's wife said, "Oh, he's already a Christian." Well, she's a non-practicing Catholic. And so she probably means, yeah, he's a Christian because he's not a Buddhist or a Muslim, you know? And so Benny's down again to him. "Bruce, would you like to, you know?" And so all of his atheistic sons and daughters also crowded into the bedroom. She said it was the most intimidating atmosphere she had ever been in. Just feeling like, wow, all these people are just hovering over her to see what she's going to say, because they weren't sure they wanted to hear what she had to say. Finally, she says, "Bruce, if you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you can't talk, I want you to look me square in the eye." And he just focused in on it. Now let me ask you, did Bruce get saved? Do you remember that old hymn we used to sing? "Look and live, my brother, live. Look to Jesus now and live. 'Tis recorded in God's word. Hallelujah! It is only that we look and live." I think Bruce is getting saved this weekend. I'm kind of excited about that. But my friend, pretty intimidated, but I thought she did good work. Yeah, that's my God sighting. I got all that email this morning before I came to church, so I was busy. What have you seen God doing in this past week? Slip up your hand, guys, we'll get a microphone to you.
Couple of people, okay?
Dan, I thought it was the best concert I'd ever been to in my life. I was out. Anyone else have a God's idea you'd like to share this morning?
Just real quick, I like that last song that we did, Crowder, is playing this next Friday at Faith Assembly. So if you want to go to a concert this next Friday for that Crowder, because he has that song right now.
Okay, so that's Friday night?
Friday night at Faith Assembly.
Cool, that's great.
Never used one of these, but.
Are you doing good?
I wear this blue and black bracelet for a young police officer named Dominic. He's in Albuquerque, and he's been charged with murder because he shot a guy during a confrontation. I don't know how you feel about police officers and race relations and all that kind of stuff, but there's trials going on now. So if you could pray for Dominic and his family who are going through a terrible time, that the truth will be revealed and that God, this will be a time for Dominic and his family to open their hearts to God. His fellow officer is also charged, and he is a Christian. So just pray that, you know, God's will be done, and that Dominic and his family will see God's glory.
Let's pray, because, you know, police and race relations all across our country are very, very, very difficult right now. We want to pray that the Prince of Peace, Jesus, will be very much involved in this, because there have been really difficult things. So, Lord, first of all, I think of every law enforcement officer who puts his life on the line day after day. These men and women, they face danger, they face hostility, they try to calm down very volatile situations. They have a thankless job, Lord. So I pray that your hand would be upon every single law enforcement personnel, and that they would experience a sense of your presence, a sense of your calling them even deeper to walk with you. I pray for this Dominic down in Albuquerque. And I pray that through the process of the whole trial and everything, that the truth will come out, and that a compassionate justice will be done. I pray for the family members of the person who was shot, because they too are grieving the loss of a loved one. There are no winners in this situation, Lord. And everybody is hurting. I know that Dominic didn't want to take a life. That's not why he put on his uniform that day. So I pray, God, that there would be great wisdom and new levels of communication and cooperation that spreads across our country. I sometimes think, Lord, that you are unmasking the sin in our hearts, that you are revealing the evil that lurks all across our country. You're doing that not because you want to rub our noses in, but because you want us to come to a point of repentance. And until we see how great the need is and how deep the evil runs, and as Solzhenitsyn said, that line dividing good from evil runs through the heart of every human being, until we see that, Lord, we'll go our own independent, stubborn, self-sufficient ways. But we need you. Our country desperately needs you, Lord. Desperately. And so we cry out for your hand to be upon our country, and upon our leadership, and upon our law enforcement, and upon our citizens, that we will learn to live together in peace. That can only happen when the Prince of Peace rules in our country. And we ask for that today, Lord. Amen.
It's small, but it's a miracle.
Yes.
My friend Bernice had ear flats so close to her ear canal that they could not take it out. She went to her doctor. It was totally gone.
That is awesome. same way after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so I invite all of you to draw near today and by faith partake of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ to your soul's comfort and joy. I remind you that you need not be a member of this local church body or the Church of Nazarene International to participate, because we're not coming to the denominational table, we're coming to the Lord's table, and all of his children are always welcome to come. So ushers, would you please come and help us to experience God's presence through the blood and the bread.
Thank you.
scary moment when Jesus was crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? That was the very moment that he who had no sin became our sin. And experienced the abandonment, the estrangement, the gap between a holy God and sinful humanity. He did that for you and me, you know. Isn't that awesome? That he became our sin. That he might take it all away. The Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Drink this, all of you, to be grateful that Christ died for you. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your incredible love for us. That's a transaction that we'll never fully understand or comprehend. All we can do is bow in awe before you and say, thank you, my Lord. Thank you, my Lord, for becoming my sin, dying my death, and now restoring my life. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Well, in just a moment, I'm going to preach a short little message from Before we do, I'd ask you to come to help us worship the Lord at the beginning of our time in our office. We're delighted to have several guests with us today. If you would just take a moment and drop down your name and address on this card. I'd love to send you a note this week.
Our people
to work. That's why they were leaving, because they were looking for job opportunities. I had to take a 12% to 15% cut in salary, but I didn't bail out. Right? I'm not going to bail out. I'm not going to run away. But as I looked at this, I really had to admit the fact that there are some things about Jonah that really do describe me. And so I want to share with you my own journey through this whole starting point deal, so that hopefully you can maybe find some insights as you get your own starting point. And I think it can help us all to get into the game. You know, Jonah's story is one of the most well-known in the entire Bible, right? I mean, even non-churchgoers know about Jonah and the whale. Basic story is, God calls Jonah to go to Nineveh. Jonah says, no way, and he heads west on a ship instead of east to Nineveh. And this huge storm comes up, and the sailors toss him overboard, and the storm immediately calms down. Jonah is swallowed by a whale. He spends 3 days and nights in the belly of the fish. Eventually, Jonah is vomited out on the land, cleans himself up, and heads off reluctantly to Nineveh, where he preaches a message of gloom and doom. 40 days, and God's going to destroy you guys. People repent in sackcloth and ashes. God calls off the judgment. Jonah gets royally ticked off at God. End of story. Except that there's a lot more going on in this whale potato. I just had to do that. It's one of the cities that ISIS was trying to destroy. Nineveh, the ancient city. So, anyway, Nineveh was famous for cruelty, war, prostitution, economic exploitation, and witchcraft. Those four things, those four evils were rampant in the city of Nineveh. And Nineveh, Assyria, they were the country that overran the 10 northern tribes of Israel and called them off into captivity. And then they took other peoples from other places that they had conquered, brought them over into northern Israel. They intermarried with some of the Israelis that were left behind, and they became known as the Samaritans, the most hated people in the time of Jesus. Okay? Mixed race people, some from farther east, and some Israelis. So Nineveh was bad news. Nineveh was cruel. Nineveh was evil. And God wanted Jonah to preach against it. Now you'd think that Jonah would be glad to preach judgment against Nineveh. You know, after all, they deserved God's judgment. And they had done this horrible thing to northern Israel. But Jonah saw otherwise. Perhaps he was afraid. But let's read a little bit here. Jonah 1:1. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh, preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. And after paying the ferry, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Chapter 4, verse 2. He prayed to the Lord. Oh, Lord! Is this not what I said when I was still at home? That's why I was so quick to flee to Tarshish. I knew that you're a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger, abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Jonah actually had great insight into the character of God. That's why he ran away. Isn't that weird? He knew God so well. I know you, God! I know you! You're compassionate! You're merciful, you're kind, you're loving. You just love to cancel calamity and judgment. So Jonah, knowing what God would do if the people repented, ran away. Because he just knew that if the people listened and repented, then God would call up the judgment, and Jonah didn't want them saved. He wanted them nuked. He wanted them to die horribly, just like people in northern Israel had died horribly. He wanted revenge, not salvation. because he knew God really, really well. That is strength number one of a Jonah. They know the character of God. If you're a Jonah, you probably know God rather quickly. You have a wealth of information and insight and revelation about him, and I think that's a great strength. Don't you think the church needs lots of Jonas who know God, who have insight into his character? Don't you think we know them? That's the rest of us to know him as well. Kind of also makes me wonder about that. You see, we pastor types, we can get really frustrated with Jonas. Because we're always wanting to say, come on, get in the game. Get involved. Don't be so detached. Don't be so distant. You know, get in the game. You've got strengths. You've got insights. You've got understanding of God. Please, get into the game. Sometimes we think, well, man, if they just knew God better, they would be more involved in church. Well, maybe the reason they're not involved in church is because they know quite a bit about God. And they're a little bit scared. I met a homeless man on the streets of Spokane one day. I started sharing some stuff about the Lord with him. And, man, he knew God a lot more than I did. And I didn't judge him. But because he was living on the streets, he didn't know God. That was a bad judgment. And it could be that the person who shows up to church twice a year has some real insights into God we need to learn from them. So let's not look down on Jonas. Let's find ways to engage with them and relate to them and help invite them into the game. Help them to become a partner with God and to share the wisdom and insights that they have. Because knowing God is one of their strengths. A second strength is spiritual power. You know, after Jonah was thrown into the sea immediately calmed down. And the sailors suddenly became in awe of God. Oh, wow! This is the one true God. And they offered sacrifices to God. They made vows to God because they thought that somehow Jonah's life and what they thought was his death revealed to them the true nature of God and the kind of powerful thing that happened on a shipload of sailors. Come to know who God is. That's pretty powerful ministry. But that was nothing compared to the ministry that Jonah exhibited when he finally did get to Nineveh. When he preached there, the leading city of the evil empire, Assyria, repented. They fasted, they prayed, they turned from their evil ways. And I think that's an incredible response to Jonah's ministry. A preacher, evangelist, missionary, Sunday school teacher, or children's church worker, or youth leader who wouldn't give their right arm to see that happen when they minister. We want to see people repent. We want to see people turn. I saw this cartoon in a magazine one day, and a whole bunch of people were pouring out of a church building, and they had their pastor up on their shoulders, you know, like they just won the Super Bowl or something. And one bystander says to another bystander, wow, I wonder what he preached about today. Powerful impact. We all want to have a powerful impact, whether we are working in the nursery, or working with teenagers, or we're out planting a church somewhere. We want to see something powerful happen. We long for God to move. That's what happened when Jonah preached. God moved powerfully. Well, by the time I saw these two strengths, you know, Jonah is spiritually powerful and he has great insight into the character of God, I started to feel a little bit better about myself. Oh, okay. I don't mind being a Jonah. I have a full group of strengths. You know, maybe I know the Lord better than I think I do. Maybe I have more spiritual power and authority than I realize I have. You know? It's almost 11:30, but I got time for a story. You're all recording the Seahawks game anyway, right? I was in a Bible study and it was held at my office in Othello, and this was a number of years ago, over 20 years ago, and it was a really intense sharing, and a lady right in the middle of that, as we were around and playing the final prayer, she just collapsed in the heat. I mean, just collapse, you know. And so I asked if she would come to my office the next day, and that she and Kathy and I would meet with her, and we would try to, you know, figure out what was going on. Because, I mean, when she came to, she was really you know, people were sharing really, really personal things, and maybe it just kind of overwhelmed your emotional circuits, and you just kind of almost fainted because of that. And I also know that you're taking some pretty powerful medicines for anxiety, and so maybe you had kind of a chemical reaction, and that caused your body to collapse. Or, I hesitated because I didn't want to plant a thought in someone's mind, or it could have been a demonic manifestation. When I said the words demonic manifestation, she was lifted up out of her chair and dumped on the floor between Kathy and I. I used the term lifted because she did not stand up and fall down. She was lifted by some force and thrown onto the ground between Kathy and I. My first thought was, well, at least now we know what we're dealing with. My second thought was, holy cow, what am I doing? And so that began a period of casting evil spirits out of this young lady who, when she was young, had been sexually molested and then led into drug abuse used by her older brother, who then committed suicide, and then she got involved in the occult. Three traumatic things which opened her life up to the harassment and oppression of evil spirits. But she was set free, because greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. Okay? I've seen people radically delivered like that. And that's just a little sample of the power that Jesus Christ has given to us, his church. And if we fail to use the power that God has given to us, people will suffer needlessly. They will be oppressed needlessly. And God's kingdom will not advance. We need Jonas to exercise the spiritual power and wisdom that God has given to you. But we all know there's this horrible flaw in Jonas. Yeah. This lack of compassion and lack of commitment to the will of God. You see, if you truly love someone, or you truly care about something, you will act. If you don't care, you won't act. When Jonah was called to go to Nineveh, he ran away because he did not want them to be saved. He had no compassion in their heart for them. He did not share God's heart for the Ninevites. And even when he reluctantly obeyed and he went to preach and the people all repented, chapter 4, verse 1, we read, quote, Jonah was greatly displeased and became angry. He's displeased with God. He's mad at God because his lack of compassion and his lack of commitment to God's mission of saving every single person on earth, his lack of that was monumental. And that lack threatened to wipe out the spiritual wisdom that he had and the spiritual power that he had. So with somebody who is wise and powerful, God has to use some kind of methodologies to get their attention. So God did act drastically in Jonah's case. He sent this violent storm that threatened everybody's lives. And sometimes, in a Jonah's life, really, really bad things happen. They've been allowed to happen by God. I don't think they're caused by God, but they're allowed to happen by God because he loves you too much to let you keep on running away from him. God is trying to get people's attention. And some of the horrible things that happen to people are all used by God to get their attention. I can tell you stories today of people who filed bankruptcy, people who have lost jobs, people who have gone through divorces, people who have experienced ill health, even near-death experiences, before they finally woke up and realized that God loved them, that they had been running away from God, and because he loved them so much, he allowed negative things to come into their life in order to draw and woo them to himself. If you're in a storm today, it could be because God loves you too much to let you run away from him any longer. Secondly, not only was God rather drastic in his methodology with Jonah, he was also very compassionate. Chapter 1, verse 17, God provided a great fish to swallow Jonah. So in the midst of this violent storm, when everything looks like it's life and death, and death is going to win, there is a means of escape. There is a way of salvation. Because God did not want Jonah's death. He wanted his love and obedience. He doesn't want your death. He doesn't want my death. He wants our love and our obedience. And so compassionately, God provided a great fish to swallow Jonah and save him. Now, would the belly of a fish feel like salvation to you? Would it feel like an act of God's compassion? I mean, there you are. It would feel like the end of the road. I'm going to die. I'm going to die swallowed by this great fish. Good smell. The worst smell in the world. You've got stomach acids that are beginning to dissolve your skin. I actually think that's part of the reason why when he went to Nineveh, the people repented because his skin falling on his body. Because he was like half digested. And so when he got up there and said, 40 days and judgment's coming, they're all going, oh wow. Because this guy, if you've already shared it. Sometimes a stinky fish's belly is the compassion of God, giving us a place of refuge where we can repent, tie the finger, turn back to Him. Then at the very end of the story, there is this funny little deal about a vine that grows up by shade for Jonah. He really likes the vine, and then a worm comes along, kills the vine, and he loses the shade, and he's just ticked off all over again. I mean, he's been sitting under the vine, hoping that God would still do them, but still pretty upset because he figured God was going to call it off. And he's just mad. I mean, he's just mad about everything. And then the vine dies. You know, just like a last straw. You know, not only are you not backing up my word of vengeance, not only are you not killing these horrible sinners, you're forgiving them. And now you killed my vine. Just can't take it any longer. I'm ready to die. Just kill me, Lord. Just keep me out of here. And God says, chapter 4, verse 10, you've been concerned about this vine, though you did not tend it, and you did not make it grow. It sprang up overnight, and it died overnight. But Nineveh has more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their way down from their left and many cattle as well. Should I not be concerned about this great city? In trying to help Jonah understand that God's heart is for the salvation of every single person on earth. Maybe even including the cattle, I don't know. But he cares deeply about everything. God reveals his heart to Jonah. He uses tough love. He uses hard knocks. But it's all designed to help him feel towards people what God feels towards people. To see people with God's eyes and to relate to them with God's heart. Are you a Jonah? Well, I am. And that has helped me to understand why I've gone through some things I've gone through in my life. I understand my heart dead. Requires some hard knocks to gain my attention. But one thing I know for sure, from everything I've experienced and continue to experience, God loves every single human being on earth. And he calls you and I to invest ourselves in the lives of those people and to draw them into a love relationship with him as well. And that's what we're going to be about. That's our task. He died for everybody. Would you stand with me for prayer, please? But Jesus, as we prepare to go out into the world that you have created, the world that you want to rule to yourself, help us to be winsome. Help us to be kind, because it's the kindness of God that leads to repentance. Help us to care enough to go to that dying neighbor and pray with them. Help us to take a plate of cookies to that new person who moves into the neighborhood. Help us to help that guy at work who's shouldering a heavy load, and we offer to come alongside and carry some of the load. Help us to see that student in the classroom at school that other people ignore. Help us to build a relationship and a bridge to them. In all things, Lord, help us to be authentic followers of you in love and obedience. And as we pray, in your powerful and awesome name, amen. Go with God. Have an awesome week.